The boxers have been given their instructions. The seconds are out. The crowd is ready for another edition of Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing with your presenter, the boxing historian, Greg Rashid.
Well, I want to say swatty cup to everyone out there. This is Greg Rashid with another edition of the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. And yes, swatty cup means hello in Thai. If you're new to the program, I'm in Bangkok, Thailand. Very hot today, but I love it hot. And this show is always hot. We always have a fun time here. If you're new to the program, what we do on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast, that we do fantasy fights. For instance, if Muhammad Ali fought Mike Tyson, what would happen? Or what would happen if Rocky Marciano fought Tyson Fury? These are just imaginary fights, and we use various modalities. Today, we're going to be using Title Bout 2 PC game created by Jim Trunza. But we use other modalities, too, in this. But it's all about fun, because if you're listening to the program, you're a boxing aficionado. You sit around sometimes, talk to your buddies, and you say, I wonder what would happen if Joe Lewis fought Lennox Lewis. I know you do that. So that's what we do on this program. Plus, we do latest boxing news. We also do boxing history. And we have interviews from time to time with folks in the field of boxing and actual boxers. And also, sometimes we deviate and do some other interviews with important people in the news. And what we also do on here, we always conclude the program with some music. And that's why we call this a boxing variety show. But we're going to get to our fight right now. And we're going to have Knockout Nigel. And again, as I said, this is being simulated by Title Bout 2 PC game. And this is a lightweight fight between Joel Casamayor and Boom Boom Mancini. Ray Boom Boom Mancini. So we'll go down to the mat now and get this fight going. And here's Knockout Nigel.
Cheers. This is Knockout Nigel, your humble commentator for today's match from Anfield, home of Liverpool, the Premier League's greatest team. I have my red bubbly once again in honor of my Liverpool mates. The crowd is here to see an intriguing 12-round bout between lightweights Joel Casamayor versus Ray Mancini. The referee will be Stanley Christodoulou and will be judged on the 12-point must system. I will take a sip of this superb Liverpool bubbly as the bell begins for round one. The fighters are in ring center. Casamayor lands a 3-point left cross. Casamayor lands a 3-point right jab. Casamayor misses with a left cross, then lands a 2-point right jab. Casamayor is moving about the ring, trying to establish position. Mancini lands a 2-point left jab. Casamayor is admonished for a low blow. Casamayor lands a 2-point right jab. Casamayor lands a 2-point left cross. Mancini suffers a major cut over the left eye. Casamayor misses with a right jab. Mancini lands a right hook for 5 points. Casamayor is rocked. Ray Mancini scores 5 points. Joel Casamayor is rocked. Casamayor clinches. Mancini pushes him away and lands a 3-point left uppercut. Mancini's corner is working feverishly on his cut left eye. Mancini is known to cut easy. That was a close round to call. Casamayor scored 10 points to 13 for Boom Boom. Ah, Liverpool bubbly. This best to sip during a bout or at any time as round two starts. Mancini lands a 3-point right uppercut. Mancini lands a 3-point right hook. Mancini lands a 2-point left uppercut. Mancini with a 5-point left cross that stuns Casamayor. Casamayor lands a 2-point combination. Mancini suffers a cut inside the mouth. Casamayor has cut off the ring and pinned Mancini on the near ropes. Casamayor lands a four-point right jab. Mancini clinches. Both fighters are warned for excessive holding. Casamayor lands a two-point combination. Casamayor lands a two-point left cross. Mancini suffers a major cut under the right eye. Casamayor lands a five-point left cross that causes Mancini to stumble back. Mancini steps forward to score a five-point combination that has Casamayor nearly floored. Only the ropes are holding him up. Mancini moves in for the kill, but the bell to end round two stops him. Casamayor walks gingerly back to his corner. If Mancini had only a few more seconds, Casamayor would have potentially been a knockout victim. Mancini's is a bloody mess, with cuts over his eyes and in his mouth. His corner is doing its best to clean him up. A close round, but I give it to Mancini. He had 19 points to 15 for Casamayor. I will take a break from the bubbly for a while. One sip of Liverpool bubbly lasts forever in your mouth. Round three begins with Casamayor, landing a two-point left cross. Casamayor lands a hard left hook for 5 points. Mancini's knees did a dip. Casamayor lands a two-point left cross. The fighters are in ring center. Casamayor lands a crushing left hook that knocks down Mancini. Mancini gets back to his feet at the count of four. Casamayor lands a two-point right jab. Casamayor connects a four-point left cross that knocks Mancini into the neutral corner. Mancini clinches. Mancini lands a two-point left hook. Casamayor lands a three-point left hook as the bell ends round three. Casamayor dominated the third with 21 points to 2 for Mancini. Let's see if Mancini can bounce back to begin round four. Casamayor misses with a combination. Mancini counters with a four-point left cross that gets Casamayor's attention. Casamayor lands a two-point right uppercut. The fighters are in ring center. Casamayor lands a two-point combination. Mancini misses with a left jab. Casamayor lands a two-point combination. Casamayor lands a three-point right jab. Casamayor lands a two-point left cross. Casamayor lands a three-point left uppercut. Mancini is trying to cover up, but the punches are going through his guard. His corner looks very concerned as round four ends. Casamayor was on cruise control in the fourth with 14 points to 4 for Mancini. Mancini is getting confused by Casamayor's southpaw style. At least his corner has prevented further bleeding on Mancini's cuts. Round 5 begins with Casamayor landing a two-point right jab. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor lands a two-point left cross. Mancini lands a crushing five-point left cross that knocks down Casamayor. Casamayor walked into that shot with his hands down. Casamayor gets back to his feet at the count of three. He says he is all right, but he looks shaky. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor counters with a three-point left cross. Mancini misses with a right hook. Mancini clinches. Mancini misses with a combination. Great head movement by Casamayor. Casamayor lands a five-point combination. Mancini is knocked into the neutral corner. Casamayor misses with a right hook. Mancini is saved as the bell ends round five. That was an interesting round. Casamayor was knocked down, but he ended up dominating the rest of the round. Casamayor scored 12 points, to Mancini had 5. I need to guzzle a little bubbly to figure this out, as round 6 begins. The fighters meet at ring center. Casamayor lands a hard 5-point left hook that buckles Mancini's knees. Casamayor lands a 3-point combination. Casamayor misses with a right jab. Casamayor lands a 2-point left hook. Casamayor has cut off the ring and pinned Mancini in the right neutral corner. Casamayor lands a 3-point left uppercut. Mancini misses with a left cross. Mancini clinches. Mancini misses with a combination. Casamayor lands a three-point right hook. Casamayor lands a two-point left hook. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor misses with a counter, left uppercut, as round six ends. Casamayor showed superb defensive skills in the sixth. Mancini was throwing at air. He had 0 points landed to 18 for Casamayor. Mancini needs to step it up in the seventh, or it will be a short night for him. Mancini lands a two-point left hook. The fighters are in ring center. Mancini scores a five-point left hook. Casamayor almost goes down and is knocked into the far ropes. Mancini has gotten his second wind. Mancini lands a three-point left hook. Mancini lands a two-point right cross. Casamayor misses with a right cross. Mancini counters with a right hook for 5 points. Casamayor's knees buckled. Casamayor lands a two-point right jab. The fighters are in ring center. Mancini lands a four-point hook that snaps Casamayor's head back. Mancini lands a two-point left hook. Casamayor misses with a left cross, then lands a two-point left hook. The fighters continue to fight as the bell ends round seven. Mancini got his second wind in the seventh. Maybe he had a sip of Liverpool bubbly to give him some fistic energy. Casamayor was not expecting Mancini to wake up in this round. Mancini had 24 points to only 4 points for Casamayor. Round eight begins Casamayor landing a partially blocked one-point left uppercut. Casamayor lands a four-point left uppercut. Casamayor is moving about the ring, trying to establish position. Casamayor lands a three-point right cross. Casamayor lands a two-point left uppercut. Mancini clinches. Mancini misses with a right cross. Casamayor lands a two-point combination. Mancini lands a two-point right uppercut. Mancini lands a two-point combination. Casamayor clinches. Casamayor lands a four-point snapping uppercut at the bell. Casamayor went back to his dominating ways in the eighth. I wonder if Casamayor was taking a break in the seventh. He had 16 points to 4 for Mancini. Round 8 points scored. Joel Casamayor, 16 Ray Mancini. 4 Mancini lands a 2-point right uppercut to begin round 9. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor misses with a counter combination. Casamayor misses with a left cross. Mancini misses with a counter left uppercut. Mancini lands a 2-point right cross. The fighters are in ring center. Mancini lands a 2-point left hook. Casamayor lands a 2-point right jab. Casamayor lands a 2-point left cross. Mancini lands a 4-point left cross. Casamayor misses with a combination. Mancini lands a 2-point left jab. The bell ends the round. Mancini stood with Casamayor and ended up dominating the ninth. Mancini had 13 points to 4 for Casamayor. A little swag of Liverpool bubbly will go down well as round 10 begins. Casamayor lands a 2-point left cross. Casamayor misses with a right jab, but his 5-point left hook connects. Mancini staggers into the near ropes. Casamayor lands a 2-point combination. Casamayor lands a 2-point right jab. Casamayor lands a 2-point left hook. Mancini is trying to cover up. He grabs Casamayor into a headlock, causing the referee to admonish him. The fighters are in ring center. Casamayor is moving about the ring, trying to establish position. Casamayor lands a 2-point left hook. Casamayor lands a 2-point right jab. Casamayor lands a 3-point left hook. Casamayor scores a 4-point left hook that sends Mancini into the neutral corner. He looks like he is ready to go. One of his cornermen has a towel in his hand. Is he going to throw it in the ring? Thank goodness for Mancini. The bell ends round 10. Casamayor gave Mancini another boxing clinic in that round. Mancini looked clueless in the 10th. He had no points to 24 points for Casamayor. The referee is telling Mancini to start fighting, or he may stop the fight. Mancini misses with a combination at ring center. Mancini misses with a left uppercut. Casamayor counters with a partially blocked left uppercut for 1 point. Mancini lands a 3-point combination. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor misses with a counter left cross. Casamayor lands a 2-point right cross. Casamayor lands a 3-point left hook. Mancini lands a 3-point combination. Mancini misses with a left cross. Casamayor counters with a 4-point combination that shook Mancini. Casamayor misses with a right jab. Mancini misses with a left cross as round 11 ends. A slower pace round. Mancini tried to pick it up in the 11th, but Casamayor was still in control. He had 10 points to 6 for Mancini. Mancini rushes out to begin round 12. Mancini misses with a left uppercut. Mancini lands a 2-point combination. Casamayor clinches. Casamayor is admonished for headbutting. Mancini misses with a left uppercut. Casamayor counters with a partially blocked right jab for 1 point. Mancini lands a 2-point right cross. Casamayor lands a 3-point left hook to the stomach. Mancini lands a 2-point right cross. Mancini lands a 2-point left hook. Casamayor lands a 2-point left hook to close out the round. Mancini did show a little in the 12th, but was it enough to win it? He had 9 points to 6 for Casamayor. I am going to take another swig of this amazing Liverpool bubbly as we await the decision. Judge number 1 scores the bout for Joel Casamayor, 1-1-3 to 1-1-1. Judge number 2 scores the bout even, 1-1-2 to 1-1-2. The third judge scores the bout for Joel Casamayor, 1-1-2 to 1-1-1. For the winner by majority decision is Joel Casamayor. Wow, that was much closer than I imagined. If Mancini had fought back in the 10th round and got a couple of points, he would have tied or maybe won the fight. I didn't see it as that close of a match. Maybe these blokes will hook up again in another bout. Meanwhile, I am going to hook up with a solid gulp of Liverpool bubbly as I return you to our Bangkok studio. This is Knockout Nigel. Cheers.
All right. Thank you, Knockout. That was an interesting bout. And actually, as I'm listening to the fight, and like I said, I don't know what's going to happen in these fights when I simulate them. But, you know, listening, it looked like Casamayor was dominating. It would be an easy win. But that, according to the judges of that fight, it was very close. And like Knockout Nigel said, if Ray Mancini had fought in the 10th, just a little bit, and got maybe 6 points, he may have won that fight. That's amazing. So I don't know if they wanted to take or not, but hope you enjoyed that fight today. You know, we always like to have these simulations. And as I always say, you can promote a fight. So if you have a fighter you're interested in, two fighters you want to see fight, and we have women too available to fight on these shows, just let me know. Wherever you listen to this program, please just send a message to me. And I didn't do it at the early part of the show, but I'll do it now. I want to shout out, as I always do, the folks that listen, and I love everyone that listens to the program, but I have a special affection for those who listen every Sunday afternoon at 3 p.m. Mountain Time on KUHSDenver.com out in Colorado, created by the one and only Henry Archuleta. I'm so happy to have all my friends that listen in to the program who have followed me for many years on this platform and so many other programs I've had in the Colorado region. And like I always say, I'm hoping to get back there soon. You never know. But anyway, I'm here right now, loving Thailand. And what we're going to do right now, we're going to do a little bit of, I guess we'll give you some boxing news here by the one and only Jessica, who calls herself the martial arts champion. And we don't know what martial art, but she calls herself that. So let's see what Jessica has to say for some of the news events, starting with the continued controversy. And it's only controversy made by idiots, bimbos on the internet, about Khalifa, the fighter from Algeria who won the gold medal in the women's division this year in Paris. It's still going on, so Jessica's going to talk about that right now on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Algerian boxer Iman Khalif has not been banned from boxing nor stripped of her Olympic gold medal, according to the International Olympic Committee, IOC, the World Boxing Organization, WBO, and her coach, who all separately spoke to Reuters in response to false claims online. An Octi 3 Facebook post opens new tab, said, "The end for the Olympic liar." Iman Khalif stripped of gold medal and banned for life after WBO confirms male gender identity. Khalif won gold in the women's welterweight category at the Paris Olympics in August. Her participation in the Games reignited debate over her eligibility to compete after she was disqualified by the International Boxing Association, IBA, from the World Championships a year earlier. The IBA said Khalif failed a sex chromosome test. The IOC, which in 2023 stripped the IBA of its status as the global governing body for boxing, cleared Khalif to compete in the 2024 Olympics and said the IBA's gender tests were illegitimate and lacked credibility. Speaking to Reuters about the claims on social media that include Khalif being stripped of her Olympic title, an IOC spokesperson said, "There is absolutely no truth in these claims." A spokesperson for the WBO opens new tab, which sanctions professional boxing bouts, told Reuters via email that it cannot impose suspensions, fines, or bans on non-professional boxers. The WBO does not have personal or subject matter jurisdiction over amateur boxers, such as Khalif, as we do not regulate or govern amateur boxing. The WBO added that a doctor who opined about Khalif's gender on an OG 14 WBO podcast opens new tab episode was speaking as a guest. Khalif's boxing coach, Mohamed Chawa, told Reuters via WhatsApp that social media claims relating to the WBO suspending Khalif and stripping her of titles were false. The Algerian Boxing Federation, which did not respond to Reuters' request for comment, said in an Octi 3 Facebook post, opens new tab that all false news about Algerian boxing in general and the Olympic champion, Iman Khalif, in particular, is baseless and has no connection to the International Olympic Committee. When contacted by Reuters, an IBA spokesperson did not comment on the social media claim about Khalif's Olympic medal, though said the association stood by the results of its gender tests in 2023.
You got these idiots in their little basement just causing Facebook problems because they don't have anything to do. They're on the internet doing a little bit of everything. But Khalif, I mean, just leave her alone. But this next story is still about Khalif, but it's special attention to Colorado because one of your representatives, that I'll be nice, Lauren Boebert, she got in on this whole thing. So let's hear what Jessica has to say about Lauren Boebert on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Lauren Boebert's anti-trans campaign that tried to raise funds for an Olympic boxer who quit seconds into a bout against a fighter falsely accused of being a biological male has failed miserably. The embattled Colorado congresswoman launched a fundraiser for Italian athlete Angela Carini in August after she abandoned her boxing match against Algerian athlete Iman Khalif. Khalif was at the center of a media storm during the Summer Games when she was wrongly accused of being transgender. Now it has emerged that Carini's coach rejected Boebert's fundraising efforts and the money is being returned to donors. A person with XY chromosomes was allowed to compete against actual biological women in the Olympics, Boebert said in a September 30th post on X. Americans were rightly outraged and gave generously to my Give Sengo fund for Angela Carini, one of the women who was beaten up in the ring, and that had to stop her match to avoid being seriously injured. The fundraiser argued that Carini's chance at a gold medal had been stolen. It aimed to raise $196,000, the equivalent of Italy's gold medal prize money. As of August 15th, it had garnered $67,000. Every dollar contributed will go directly to Angela Carini, the description read. But Carini didn't want the money. After my team heard from Angela's coach, we were informed that she didn't want to continue with what has been a difficult chapter in her life. While she appreciated the support by so many, she decided not to accept the funds. Bobert wrote on X this week, GiveSendGo refunded the contributions late last week as a result. Thank you to everyone who stepped up to right this wrong. Your generosity is overwhelming, she added.
Yeah, Bobert, No, that's right. I won't be political on this show. I'm going to keep it it's all boxing and combat news. Just to say, no, I won't say that. But anyway, speaking of Colorado, this is another little story about Colorado, about one championship that you should be very proud of, unlike with Bobert. But anyway, Jessica's going to tell you about this, so let's hear this on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Among the 12 planned One Championship spectacles for 2025, two will happen on U.S. soil, marking a continued commitment to expanding its reach across North America. This announcement follows the success of 1-168 Denver this past September. The extravaganza, held at Ball Arena, outperformed WWE's two major events in the same venue. This is according to the report of veteran professional wrestling journalist Dave Meltzer. This feat is particularly outstanding given that the organization's events are predominantly held in Asia. The world's largest martial arts organization first entered the U.S. market in May 2023 with One Fight Night 10, which took place at One State Bank Center in Broomfield, Colorado. To see such significant growth in popularity for just its sophomore American offering was described as mind-boggling by Meltzer. The idea that One, in the same market, could beat Raw in Gate is mind-boggling, Meltzer wrote in the September 23rd edition of the Wrestling Observer newsletter, especially when you consider that the gate for One in Denver was more than the entire gate of every single show the promotion did every single year, dating back to at least 2018.
That's really something. And Colorado, you should be very proud of that. And if you haven't checked out One, and they'll be back next year, check them out. You will really, really love those events. They are really fun. And they're based here, so I get to go to see the One Championships here. They are really fun, just exciting events. But anyway, speaking of excitement, it's about, if you can say what you want about the upcoming Tyson-Paul fight, but let's hear what Mike Tyson has to say about that, as interpreted by Jessica.
Lauren Boebert's and Mike Tyson isn't expecting much of a fight when he squares off with Jake Paul next month. The legendary boxer said he doesn't anticipate Paul will go the distance. That is, if he doesn't try to run from Tyson. If I don't have to catch him, you can expect a round one knockout, Tyson said, per ESPN's Andreas Hale. But I may have to catch him because I anticipate this guy running from me. When Tyson steps into the ring at AT&T Stadium in Arlington, Texas, on November 15th, it will be his first time fighting since his exhibition bout with Roy Jones Jr. in 2020. Before then, his last fight was against Corey Sanders in 2006. Tyson hasn't fought professionally since 2005. Nonetheless, the 58-year-old said he feels great heading into his fight with the YouTuber-turned-boxer. When I was fighting professionally, I was too stressed out, Tyson said. I never had a chance to relax or enjoy my championships because everything was coming at me. There were lawsuits and divorces. I never enjoyed myself as a human being. This is a moment in time when I can enjoy myself as a human being. I have better life skills now than I did while fighting. Paul, who boxed for the first time professionally in 2020, has a 10-1 record with 7 knockouts. His only loss came to Tommy Fury in 2023, and he beat Mike Perry via TKO in July, a fight that came on the day he and Tyson were supposed to fight originally. Given the 31-year age difference, Paul is expected to handle Tyson, but Iron Mike seems to have plenty of confidence as the fight nears.
We shall see. I think the fight is going to... For a while, I actually thought the fight wasn't going to happen. But I think it's going to happen now. And we shall see what happens in that. You know, it's... I think Tyson's going to... He should win it. Well, we'll see. We'll see. But something that Jessica hasn't talked about, I want to talk about real quickly. I've talked about it on previous shows. And probably you know the results now if you're listening to this on Sunday, October the 13th. But there's a huge, huge fight going on in this weekend. And I'm talking about Arturo Beterbiev versus Dmitry Bivol in the light heavyweight division to crown a undisputed light heavyweight champion. That hasn't happened in over 20-some years. And that's going to be a real dynamite fight. And we simmed that fight on here. And Bivol won the fight. He won it in the 8th round. So we'll see what happens. It's going to be exciting. I think Bevel's going to win that fight. I know a lot of people are saying, well, Beterbiev, he just hits too hard. But I think Dmitry's going to win that fight. But what do you think? What do you think? By the time you'll listen to this, this podcast, we'll know. We'll know. But anyway, we're going to get to one more thing with Jessica. She has some news. It's time for a little bit of boxing history for the week of October 13th through the 19th. So let's hear what Jessica has to say.
This is Jessica, your martial arts champion, with boxing history for the week of October 13th through 19th. October 13th, 1936, Sixto Escobar retained the world bantamweight title with a first-round knockout over Indian Quintana. October 14th, 2006, Mikel Kessler unified the WBC and WBA super middleweight titles after knocking out Marcus Beyer. October 15, 2005, Reggie Strickland lost for the 276th time, a record for the most professional defeats. October 16, 1942, National Boxing Association froze the titles of those serving in the armed services. October 17, 2009, Arthur Abraham defeated Jermaine Taylor with less than 10 seconds left in the fight as part of the Super 6 tournament. October 18, 2008, Bernard Hopkins defeated Kelly Pavlik via unanimous decision. October 19, 1923, Ben Johnson persuaded American League owners to prohibit boxing in their parks.
Thank you for that, Jessica. And, you know, I really want to interview Reggie Strickland. I mean, the fact that... he lost 264 fights. I mean, and just, and I've read an article about him, and he really, you know, he said that, you know, he doesn't consider himself a loser, and I don't think he's a loser. Anyone that steps in that ring, they're winners. I mean, that's hard to do. I ain't never done it. You know, I've only done a little mixed martial arts fighting, but not serious getting into a boxing ring and trying to avoid getting hit upside my head. So, you know, so Strickland, even though he has the record for most losses ever by a professional boxer, he's not a loser. And I'm hoping one day to get him on here and just interview him. Because from what I've seen from articles about him, I mean, he talks well. He, you know, no health problems, nothing like that. He just likes to fight. He likes boxing. And as he said, he gets a little money every time he fights, so ain't nothing wrong with that. And I'm going to see if I can interview him. But right now, we're going to switch gears a little bit. And before we do that, I just want to say, for those of you out there that haven't become Patreons, like the one and only Al Red Sox fan, please, please become a Patreon to the site. Go to patreon.com, look for Ringside Fantasy Fights and News. Again, Ringside Fantasy Fights and News, and donate $1 a month, whatever you can do, as some other folks have done, like our Red Sox fan, so we can keep the lights on here, get a better mic, get some more equipment, some more computer equipment, just a little bit of everything to make this the best show possible for the folks out there that listen to the show religiously. So thank you so much. Please do that. But right now, as I always say, this is a boxing variety show. We're going to We're going right now to the music portion of this program. I want to say this. There's a guy I've met over here, an expat named Jack Berry. And he's someone who has lived in Thailand for over 30-some years and an incredible, I read incredible guitar player, a legend over in this part of the world, also in Europe. You say Jack Berry, and people know his name automatically. And he's just living the retired life now, but he still plays from time to time. He's just an amazing fellow. And we were talking early in the week about guitar players like Albert King and, you know, folks like that. And so I'm going to do a little blues night now, starting with Albert King. This is live from the Fillmore East out in San Francisco, where Jack is from. And I'm going to play right now Albert King, Blues Power, on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast.
Day to another, everybody has the blues. Can you dig it?
Yeah.
Now you take a little baby that's laying in the cradle, kicking and hollering and going on and tearing up the little baby bed, can't get that milk bottle fast enough, it's got the blues. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Now you take this girl, got this main squeeze. That's a boyfriend, you know. And he just bought a brand new GTO. You know she wanna be with him every time he cranks it up. If he ain't going nowhere but around the corner to the soda fountain, she wanna be right with him and show it off. This is why all the guys and gals be, you know. And this particular night, she's getting ready to go out. The mother said, whoa, wait a minute. You can't make it tonight, daughter. You were just out last night. That too many nights in a row. And she'll go in the room and fasten the door. And won't eat, won't talk to nobody. What's wrong with her? I can't hear you. What's wrong with her? She sure enough got the blues. Some people call them the reds, the pink, but when you get through, it's the old-fashioned country blues, that's all it is. I ain't seen my main squeeze in 10 long weeks today. You know I got them.
Thank you.
I think we might be...
How about this funk? Ow, 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 funk. look like you. After all, you know it's time for everything.
Man, that bass was kicking on that. And that was the one and only Howlin' Wolf and Don't Make Fun of Me, or Don't Make Fun of Me. And anyway, and before that we did the amazing Johnny Guitar Watson and Funk Beyond the Call of Duty. And then we started to set off with the great Albert King and Blues Power. And that was from Live at the Fillmore, 1970. Hope you enjoyed that music on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. But we're getting ready to get out of here now. Hope you enjoyed the show today. And as I always say, you want to be a promoter of a fight? Just give me a holler on wherever you listen to this program, be it on KUHSDenver.com or on iHeart or on Spotify, Apple, Amazon, wherever you listen. Just let me know, as so many people have. And if you want some music on here, you want me to play some certain music, because I have tons of music over here in Thailand, just let me know. And anyone you want me to interview in the world of boxing or anywhere in general, just let me know. But anyway, this is Greg Rashid. Go in love, go in peace. And always remember, when you get up in the morning, get up, go in the mirror, look at yourself and say, I love myself. And give yourself a big, big, big hug. If you're sight impaired, get up, hug yourself and say, I love myself, and hug yourself. Because if you don't love yourself, you can't do anything. You can't love anyone because you don't even love yourself. You know, you can't even be around yourself. You can't do anything. So love yourself first, and then get out in that community, wherever you are, in farm area, prefecture, anywhere, in the city, in the country, you know, wherever you are, do something to make that area better. Clean up, pick up trash. Help a young person, help a senior, help an animal who might be in need, whatever you can do, because we're all in this sphere together. And it's one, you know, we all come here and we have to go to another place. But do what you can while you're here to make it a better place. There are wars and rumors of wars out there, but do something in your little small itsy-bitsy way to make it a better place by being peaceful vibrations in your area. But again, this is Greg Rashid. Go in love, go in peace. We'll see you next time on the Shoulder Roll Virtual Boxing Podcast. Have a great week. Take care.
Thanks for tuning in. Please remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe to this channel. Thanks, and have a great day.